next week or so. But as you know, I was here at the last meeting, and Joe and I are tag teaming on this to ensure some continuity and learn from you folks as to what's going on from the respective committees. Do everybody have the paperwork from the agenda and so on? Is there anything that people want to add to this? I mean, obviously, our discussions here are informal and relatively free-ranging, shall we say. But is there anything else in here that people obviously want to bring up as a major issue? Okay. It's a non-binding question as well. So if something occurs...
It's fluid throughout the meeting, right? So we should probably have a motion to accept the minutes.
Yeah. I'll get there in just a second. I would like to, if possible, keep things moving along. So along those lines, we have the minutes before us from the last meeting. So I'd like to make a motion to accept those, or if not, any changes suggested, a motion to accept the minutes?
Motion to accept.
Okay, thank you, Karen. Motion to accept, any second?
Second.
Doug, made and seconded, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any against? Any abstentions? Anybody not know what the minutes are? Okay, good. So we're all set to go. So first point was, I think, stimulated by many people at the last meeting. I think, Karen, you brought up in particular as well, is it might be worthwhile having a brief discussion as to how we got where we are today. For some people, even though we're veterans in town, some people think that, oh, this just sort of came out of nowhere. When in reality, it's been informal and formal discussions for a number of years. And so it would be good just to sort of go over that. Why certain town departments are involved and others aren't. Like the Harbor Master, I guess that's a real obvious one because the Harbor Master is going to be located at the harbor. But, you know, who are the moving pieces and why are the moving pieces there? So, you want to start? You want me to start on that?
Sure. I can give sort of a broad brush. I mean, one of the things after we had the first meeting last month was, based on the good questions that folks asked, was what Rick said, is how did we get here? And realize that we've been so involved behind the scenes for the last 18 months that new people coming on board or whatever don't see sort of the whole picture and how we got. Or like some folks were just involved in certain pieces, like maybe the library or maybe Gates, and didn't see how the other ones sort of fell into that. So one of the things that the board has a retreat in November of each year and discusses what their goals are. And one of the recurring themes was the lack of a sort of ongoing and robust capital plan for the community, and also the condition of the public facilities. And the challenge was that we just didn't have one public facility that needed attention and maintenance or repair or a significant amount of capital infused in it. We had dozens. And foremost among that was the Gates School and the need to have significant funds invested in that facility just as a facility, regardless of it, what it was, or just in terms of bringing it up to more efficient standards in terms of energy and heat utilization and things like that. So that also was at the same time that discussions continued about the fact that the senior center is essentially in an 1800 and something one room building, and the needs of the seniors were increasing, and yet the facility has only 11 parking spaces and really could not be segregated for different programs at the same time. The kitchen could not do Meals on Wheels, and so the services that the Council on Aging could provide were limited by the building. This building in particular, and many, many people don't know that, is they think, where was the original town hall? Or, you know, what school was this before it became a town hall? This building was built as a town hall using school plans. So it was theoretically, in terms of business operation, functionally obsolete the day it opened, because it was designed, as you see, to be a school with schoolrooms and not to be a town hall with essentially business offices. And the building is very small and has a number of challenges as far as our ability to service internal functions as well as pedestrian people coming on board. So quite literally, when the IT director came on, his office was built out of a closet in the assessor's office. No ventilation, no heating. So the challenges of this building continue to increase as technology changes with wiring, workstations, PCs, things like that. And then the third piece was the fact that since all of these buildings here were built at the exact same time, 1959, the police, the fire station, and town hall, they all share the same heating system. There's actually a boiler that serves the police station and the fire station that runs underground. The generator for the police station is here in this building, which when it went down, provided no backup to the police station, which we had during the storm. So this building, with the bookends of the police station and the fire station, have additional challenges because obviously too, they're how old now? 59, I should be able to do the math. 52 years, 53 years old. So that was the problem when the board was looking at capital and public facilities needs. It was like, well, what do we do first? Do we do a middle school and address that? Do we do the seniors? Do we do town hall? Do we do public safety that's changing in terms of the way they serve their mission? And what the board determined was that it could not be piecemeal, that they could not be in a position, and Rick can speak to this, where something was more important than the other, because they were all overdue in terms of getting some TLC and in terms of positioning ourselves to address, you know, serving the town needs over the next 50 to 60 years. And indeed, that's what happened here 55 years ago, is these buildings were all built at the exact same time along with the high school. So that's how we backed into how do we get to address these public facilities, and what's the best way to go about to do that. At the same time, we were looking at the energy savings contract to do energy system improvements in all the buildings. And that audit came back with multi-million dollar improvements that needed to be made to the buildings just in terms of systems, roofs, windows, boilers, so that if the status quo remains, there still needs to be a significant investment in these buildings over the next 5 to 10 years, just to keep them operating. And they're incredibly inefficient in terms of the windows and the heating systems and things like that. So that's sort of what provided the framework for that. But when the board started having this discussion, it was also in the midst of a very significant financial challenges for the town as far as where do we start first, how do we begin to get an assessment on these buildings. So the very, very first thing we did is we got CPC funds for $65,000 3 years ago to see if Gates was structurally sound, because Gates is sort of the centerpiece of everything. You know, everything and nothing can go into Gates. It can be a school, it can be town hall, it can be town hall, a library and a senior center, it can be a football stadium. Every time there was a need for a building, folks would say, oh, it can go in Gates, it can go in Gates. But we really didn't know how, you know, what condition was great it Gates was structurally. So CPC, I put an application to get $65,000 to do a structural assessment of the original part of Gates. And that study showed that the building was structurally sound. Even though the code had changed considerably, there's seismic requirements for buildings now, wind velocity, and so we didn't know whether you know, we could keep gates, shell gates, and keep the beautiful facade, or it would entirely have to come down altogether. And so the architect looked at that from a structural analysis, both in terms of it serving as a school or serving in some other capacity. But again, it was very broad brush because it was only $65,000. So once that initial structural analysis was completed, we did an addendum on the contract with money that was appropriated at the annual town meeting last year. $375,000 was appropriated for the town, sort of in a very broad brush way, to start, have a source of funds to be able to get answers to questions that we had as far as either engineering and site design analysis, if we wanted to run a sewer somewhere or if it needed a pumping station or sewer treatment, different things like that. And so the $175,000 was approved at town meeting, and $14,000 of that was allocated for the rest of the gate school to be done. So the part that wasn't the original 1914-1920 portion of the building, to see what building condition that was in, what system improvements were needed. And that was all presented to the board about 8 months ago in terms of gates, as far as what would it cost to bring the building just up to code. If everything remained the same, not code, but you know, efficient systems, boilers, windows, roofing, doors, and that was on the order of $20 to $22 million plus or minus contingencies for doing that. So that was one piece of the puzzle. The other was that
then you're left with a refurbished 1914.
Right. And as the superintendent will say, and providing 21st century education. So then we looked at programming town offices, the Council on Aging in that building, and the architect provided four different scenarios to us on how they could be located, the recreation department. And the contract provided the architect to present four scenarios, and then two of them the board would vote on, and they would do full cost estimates on how it would be to retrofit the building to do that. So that happened. The board voted that, and they are now working out full cost estimates for two programming designs for that building. At the same time, the ESCO project was approved at the same town meeting last year for $5.9 million. However, the town's only bonded 2.7 of that, because none of the buildings that are considered part of this master plan facilities right now are included in that.
What's ESCO? What's ESCO?
ESCO is the energy savings contract that recommends doing all the building and energy improvements. So 2.7 million we're doing right now in buildings that are not affected by the master plan that we're talking about here tonight. So we have sort of all these things that have been going on concurrent paths. I did an update, and I hope to do this for all of our meetings, where it just sort of shows you where the different aspects are. So we have the ESCO going on, we have the gates study going on, and then money provided at the last town meeting for the town to be invited into the eligibility period for a new middle school to be eligible for MSBA funding. So we hear about that process formally next month. $750,000 was appropriated to do the feasibility study of all the educational facilities in town, not just the middle school, but to look at what is it that we need for an educational plan for the entire Scituate School District, and what kind of buildings will be able to meet that mission. So that's where we are right now in terms of waiting for the formal invitation in March to start that feasibility process. Then the last piece, but also a very important piece, is that for the last 3 years, the library has been looking at their own facility in terms of its future need. Libraries have to do a master plan with the Board of Library Commissioners every 5 years, I think it is, to update what their needs are in terms of servicing the community. And they had applied for, they were interested in applying for a grant to do some retrofitting and expansion to the building. Town meeting approved funds for a feasibility study in order for us to be eligible to enter into that program. And the library was notified last year that we are eligible and in line to receive the funding. I don't want to say too much more about that because Mary Ellen's going to talk about it in detail in a little bit. So that's how we came to deciding that we needed a school, we need some a new public safety complex to address a number of issues, not only to age, but issues in terms of response time in the North Scituate area and the West End, and a need for more up-to-date operations with public safety, especially as they relate to dispatching. We have two separate dispatching systems in the town, emergency operations centers. We have no emergency operations centers and things like that. And then the last piece is the board acquired the Scituate Harbor Community Building, formerly Pier 44, 3 years ago. That building was acquired for $1.8 million with MBTA mitigation funds. We spent about 8 months clearing out the building and cleaning it, and it was initially rented out to the public organizations and town departments. And we found that we had to stop that process about 8 months in because there was no budget for it, there was no staffing to keep it cleaned, and it also needed some work in terms of the rug being replaced, the bathrooms bringing up to code. So the board voted to stop renting it out and just use it for meeting space until a budget could be programmed, some improvements could be made to make it a more attractive facility, and we could staff it so the DPW superintendent wasn't being called out on a Saturday night because somebody was having a shower and the toilet backed up. So Kevin can talk a little bit about that. So we have all these different things in play, and it's hard to sort of make people sort of see what the whole picture is. And so we're hoping we can, you know, help inform you folks so you can understand it better. The map up here has been color-coded, and we'll talk a little more about that later. It shows, this map right here shows, and we're having smaller ones made for you. This shows every single public building in town. When you hear, oh, we have 55 buildings and structures that we insure, I mean, that's everything. That's all in. That's pumping stations, that's wells, things like that. But this map has every public facility in it. Red is school buildings, green is town buildings, and blue is what's in play in terms of the public facilities master plan and the charge that this group is being you know, asked to help us with. And this is a blow up of that so you can see it better as far as where they're located and sort of what's in play. So that's sort of a quick overview, and we can answer any questions, but Rick, I'm sure there's stuff I've missed that you want to add.
You're very, very thorough, and you got my mental checklist, you got everything. From a different perspective though, everybody's known for a long time Gates is in tough business shape. Everybody knows that. No point in discussing it anymore. It's very, very clear. It's safe, it's environmentally sound and all that, but it's a losing battle keeping the facility going. It doesn't serve the educational needs of our students. And that's driving the bus. And once you think, okay, we need a new middle school, everything else falls into place. From a selectman's point of view, we deal with people. We deal with one situation. It's kind of cool being a selectman because you get one meeting, you've got the seniors coming in asking for something, another meeting, you've got other groups coming in, and everybody's got legitimate needs and everybody's got real needs. And we can continue on doing business as usual, cherry picking 1 year this project, cherry picking another project the next year, and cherry picking another. It's all ad hoc and there's no plan to it. And particularly in the last 5-6 years, you've seen we've done a much better job as a community assessing things that people have talked about for a long time and calling a spade and saying, are we going to do this or not? There have been some particular pieces of land that people, for example, have talked about. Oh, everybody knows there's tons of water out there. We should buy that. It's going to solve all our water problems. So 4 years ago, we spent $200,000 to see if there was, in fact, water out there. And it turned out that there wasn't. So we spent $200,000, but we ended that discussion, and we were able to put our energies and stuff elsewhere. Instead of just talking about it, let's find out if we can do it. Let's find out if people are up for it, people being the community. So we got the gates. So school's driving the bus, school's driving the school bus. And once that falls into place, and we identify locations, and obviously the state's going to tell us really where and so on and so forth, you got a whole lot of different issues. You start your game of dominoes. Pull rec department out from the high school, that's going to free up space. You pull the superintendent out of there, that's going to free up space. You co-locate town hall people with school superintendent's office, that's going to really help break down barriers between the two components of the town. Get the water department out so the citizens can do one-stop shopping. You don't have to go pay your bills in the water department, come up here for taxes, go over there to sign up your kid for rec, so on and so forth. And you know all the moving pieces. They're on the map. Tricia's spoken about it. We've all talked about it. Public safety, as Tricia just said, we need new ones. As I said at our last meeting, when I first ran 7 or 8 years ago, and some of you around here remember this, the Minot Fire Station was a huge issue. My gosh, the Mariner was writing stories about the Minot Fire Station, it seemed like every other week. And when I was running for election, I had 4 different community gatherings up in tiny little Minot, and every single one of them was about the Minot Fire Station. That issue hasn't gone away, it's just that people haven't talked about it in a while. The issue is still there. So we see this as a way that we can come together as a community, schools, town, public safety, Minot, and deliver an improved way of doing business in this town as a massive refurbishment. And if we continue on, I mean, we're a really good town. We all moved here or we chose to stay here for a reason. We're in good shape as a town. And we could, admittedly, keep going on an ad hoc basis. But we think otherwise. But the decision is going to be a town meeting. We want to see if the town thinks otherwise. If the town says, you know what, this costs too much money, and you know what, we're going to be happy ripping at each other, and, you know, 1 year this, next year that, so be it. But then we can say, you know what, when you come talk to us at Village Market, and you say, gee, why don't we do this, why don't we do that? I say, well, you had the opportunity, where were you? So let's bring it forth, let's do everything we possibly can to lower the cost of the people by getting state grants, by doing this, by saving money from wind and solar to apply to these costs and some, you know, other aspects of that. And let's come up with the best plan possible and let government do its job. Let the legislative branch, which is annual town meeting or special town meeting, let the citizens decide if this is what we want to do. So we're putting our best foot forward in this regard. And it's going to end up being more cost effective and for operations and deliver a far better product for the schools, for safety, for the seniors, right across the board.
So I guess the only thing that I add to that is that the board determined and feels very strongly and directed me and the staff to sort of work on this, is that we know there are school needs, but at the same time and equally important, there are very, very significant needs of our seniors and very, very significant needs for public safety in terms of service delivery, given how much that's changed in the last 15 years. And sometimes those needs don't get as articulated or as well known as other needs. And yet, I think, you know, to Rick's point, we know it's an expensive plan. We don't know if it's a viable plan. We don't know if the community is ever going to accept it or not. But that we have an obligation to present it to the town to say we're not looking just short term, we're looking at what the town needs for the next 30, 40, 50 years. And, you know, every building is as old as it is today and is only going to get older. And so the flip side is, if we don't approve any of these projects, we still have a, what was the total ESCO estimate when we did the audit for all the buildings?
Well, 5.9 was the...
Yeah, but that was five, right, $6 million just in energy stuff for buildings as far as systems. So, so that sort of gives you a flavor of sort of how we got here and what we're trying to do, but does anybody have any questions or is anything we missed, Jen?
Question, this all sounds really good and it's really helpful, and I'm curious if we have looked at or have a plan to look at maybe putting gates up for sale to a private developer and looking at the cost of building all these separate buildings individually. Like, what would it cost to just build a town hall instead of putting it into gates, for example, you know, and all the different ones, the senior center and so forth.
So are you suggesting selling gates?
I'm suggesting, you know, I guess it's two-pronged. Look at possibly selling gates, and then also look at what would be the cost to do each of these buildings on its own.
That last figure is a really good figure, and Karen, when we were talking, you suggested that as well, is one of the things we should be able to have at the tip of our tongues, is that last figure. So what are the cost savings, anticipated cost savings by doing this one fell swoop, and with a lot of co-location and all that sort of stuff. We know it will be, everybody we talk to, all the architects and so on, say it would be the planners we talk to, but it would be interesting to say, okay, admittedly back in the envelope, if we were to build a new senior center of such and such square footage on some piece of property all by itself, what would it cost? If we were to build all by itself a new water department on its own little piece of property, how much would that cost? And come up with that figure and have that as a benchmark against which we measure ourselves.
Okay. Did you offer that as a menu to the voters?
Yeah. Well, I think, say, again, just making a
I'm sorry, the question was...
No, not as a menu.
No,
the question...
Trish asked what the question was, and the question was, once you price it out, would you consider offering that as a menu to the voters?
Well, I'm not sure there'd be much purpose in saying, okay, voters, would you like to spend less money for one location or more money for more, but...
So the public facilities master plan that we just described is the plan that the town is going to bring to town meeting. So the issue is what kinds of questions, what kind of homework do we need to do to help address all, so if we get that, yes, we looked at that, what is this? And then the other aspect, which I know folks are going to ask, and is being worked on, sort of trying to segment the work, is how much is it going to cost, and what are you doing to offset that? What's in play that if it's $150 million, what is it that can get it as palatable as possible by selling the old Minette Fire Station, by selling the Council on Aging building, by adopting the meals tax or not, by earmarking the solar and wind revenue, things like that. All those things are in play right now, but what we've been trying to do is when we say a new public safety building is going to cost $6 million and this is what it's going to look like conceptually, we want to make sure that we have something solid saying it is $6 million. So that's actually what's happening on gates right now is, you know, we can go to different towns and say, all right, how much did you retrofit or rebuild your new town hall for 10,000 square feet or whatever. We will know exactly what the cost is to put it all in gates because the architect's working on that now. The feasibility study that is going to happen under the MSBA process is going to tell us exactly what it's going to cost to put a new school here, Man Hill, back off of the turf field. I mean, that's the other thing with the school thing is we don't tell them where a new school is going to go. And they could conceivably say, oh, you know, you can retrofit gates and go in there, although we're not taking bets that that's a likely possibility, which is why we're putting this money into gates, because we want everything to line up at the same time for the fall town meeting, because that's when the school project, if everything goes on order, will be able to go. Because no matter what happens with gates, whether it's a town hall, whether it's sold, it's eventually going to be empty because we're going to move all those kids out, and it's a 90,000 square foot building that we don't want to have plywood on. So, and now that we know it's structurally sound, you know, we probably don't want to raise it or anything like that, but that's a really good question.
And I'm not implying.
Right, no, no, and that's a really good question is, is when we throw out dollar numbers, we want to make sure that we have somebody other than us saying this is what it costs, so we know exactly, yes, it is $4 million for a new police station like it is in Norwell, and it will cost that.
And I think my point is just that we need to be able to say we've looked at all the different options.
Absolutely right.
We haven't just from the beginning thought that we were going to put all of this in Gates.
Right.
And, you know, what are the different options for making it?
And that's what you are all for, is to keep telling us what it is you need or what it is that you think we've missed or whatever. And that's why we really need, you know, your feedback on this stuff.
And can I just clarify that the one thing that you just kind of mentioned was that the MSBA are going to be the ones, the Massachusetts School Building Authority, to drive the location, if they decide that we do need a new middle school or a renovated high school, whatever that process comes out with, they're driving the location. It's not like we're saying to them, we really want it where Town Hall is.
Right, right.
There have been several circle your calendar dates already, and there's several in the future. One of the ones in the past is when it came back that Gates is structurally sound and worth doing something with. That was a milestone in this whole discussion. Because if they said, you know what, a good wind is going to knock it over someday, once you take all the books out that they're holding up the walls, sort of thing, you know, if they come back with that, that would have, you know, oriented us in one direction. Another circle your day calendar is what the MSBA says, obviously, in terms of locations. Are they going to give us one location? Are they going to give us two or three locations that are equally palatable to them? You know, I don't know, we don't know, we have some suspicions just on the basis of, as Tricia just articulated, unlikely they're going to say, do it in the current structure of Gates. But they might say, Ellis property.
Right.
They might say, put a high school on the Ellis property and put that as your junior high school, middle school, close an elementary school, you know, as you know all this, but for the rest of you, close an elementary school. And so then we're thinking, well, okay, well, you know, then what do we do? How do we do? We have to keep moving ourselves forward so we know what pieces are moving, what rough costs are, so we can be responsive. That's why when I say schools driving the bus, as the largest component financially of this, it is, you know, that's a date to circle on the calendar, as I said, because it is going to help us understand the options for the rest of the town stuff. Personally, just one of you asked me this once. I actually refer to it as a town center up at the Gates location because that's the way I prefer to think of it. Town Hall to me, you know, sounds like just a building. And my vision, my feeling about that place up there, if we can put everything in there, is it's really a town center where people go for essentially everything. And that's how I conceptualize it. Except for the public safety aspect,
So there is a committee that's going to look at that, but I mean, what our challenge is, if this, then that, if this, then that. So the committee can obviously say that our preferred site is here, but if the building MSBA feasibility recommends that it go on Ellis, then we've already discussed still raising these buildings if we go to Gates and making this all available for economic development. Because one of the challenges is this is sewered here. It's already in a main intersection or whatever that would have to be reconfigured. But so that's already, so it's sort of if this, then this, if this, then that. And we have to do that as well. If MSBA feasibility comes back and says build something on the Ellis estate, that's okay too, because there's still room for the public safety complex to be there as well, which might even be a kind of nice thing to have. But again, the sewer issue comes up. There's a dry sewer bed running all the way up 3A, so we have just assigned an engineering contract with Weston and Sampson for short money to do that analysis, saying if we wanted to do this, what will it cost? The issue is not so much as a sewer line extension, it's the treatment of the actual sewage and how that's, and so if it costs $30 million to put a school here and it's on a sewer line, but it costs $37 million to put it at Man Hill and Route 3A because of the sewer issue. You know, that's all what, you know, what we get to decide as community after they look at every potential parcel. So we're trying to figure all the different contingencies that could go with each scenario.
I've got a couple of questions. Going back to the MSBA, I know, they're trying to push this standard design.
Yeah.
And is that a requirement of theirs? Or in other words, you know, the building's already been designed. You know, why reinvent the wheel? We'll take what was just put in, make up Whitman, just built a new high school, I think.
Yeah, they call them model schools.
Yeah. Is that a requirement of MSBA? Because if it isn't, then that's something that we should explore. It could probably save,
We're actually in superintendent, we're going to have Superintendent McCarthy and Sarah, the principal, and Gabe, what's your last name, Shannon? I thought it was Shannon, but it was two first names, to come in and talk to you about that. But that's, again, very much on our radar, that we would follow the model school. Hingham is the first middle school model school being built right now. There's other model high schools like Whitman. So that's very, that reduces the overall cost impact quite significantly. The other thing, too, is all our schools sprawl, and the model now is to go to 2-3 floors again. So even conceivably, when we think, oh, how can we fit a middle school in this whole area, if we're looking at a three-story model school building, then that reduces the overall acreage, and we can look at that as well. I mean, we also are trying to be cognizant of building athletic fields that are all near each other so we can maintain them. The economies of scale of not having our DPW travel everywhere to maintain fields and things like that is also being considered as well.
Okay, and then the second question is kind of more in my line of work, and maybe it's too early, but the building has the energy code, which is a base energy code, and then there's this local option, what's called a stretch code, and the state gives you money if the town adopts it, and Scituate has adopted it. That costs extra money in a building. And I don't know what the percentage is. It could be a couple of few hundred thousand dollars in a new building. You don't need it for renovation of like the gates, but for new construction you do.
But the stretch code is going to be the state building code.
And I know there's a push to go even further, but the point being is, you know, that's kind of a long-term thing to think about is, you know, if we can save a couple hundred thousand dollars on a building, town meeting A, repeal this, and then B.
Except the town has a goal of being a green community.
Oh, I know.
We require all our buildings to be green.
You're going to do it anyway. Right. I mean, we'll do it anyway.
We end up saving money.
You do it anyway. But I'm just saying.
Marla, you have a question?
Just a date question. You say a date that we all need to keep in mind is when these studies are coming back. So do you have a ballpark idea when the MSBA feasibility study will be in your hands?
August.
So we have 270 days from the date that the funding was approved at the November town meeting. That's August. But we needed to be formally invited. We're into the feasibility period. We're in the eligibility period right now. Next month in March, we expect to be formally invited into the feasibility period, which means that's we've appointed the committee, and now we can go out of the gate, hire the consultant to do the school educational plan and the school improvement plan to meet that educational plan. And that all has to be done by August. So once that's done and in hand, then we're going to go to town meeting probably in October with that plan. That's right, Jen. I know you know this. Okay.
My understanding, though, is it, all of this has to happen at an MSBA board meeting for them to approve us to move into the next step. And their next meeting is April 4th.
It's April 4th? Okay, I thought it was March, John. So it's April 4th? Okay, so that's one. Thanks.
You can't talk to anybody about feasibility, about, you know, construction or anything until you get into that hearing.
Right, what we're trying to do is position ourselves by appointing a committee already to go, like, the day after we get that formal notification.
You can't talk to April 4th?
You can't talk to firms or anything until...
No.
So we don't want to be in a situation where April 5th we say, okay, let's start thinking.
All right, who's on the committee?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's August, just to be, I'm just trying to be clear on this.
Yeah.
So that when they come back with recommendations as to the siting of a middle school or a high school, whatever we do, that is August?
August.
That's August.
They have to have completed by, it's ambitious, but again, we're relying on the information we get from the superintendent. It's the 270 days from when we appropriated the 750 in November. That brings us to August. So the consultant and everything has to be done with all their reports, and then we have to educate the community and prepare for town meeting in October.
So April, if we're invited in, then we hire a consultant?
Right, the building committee does.
The building committee hires the consultant,
right,
and the consultant reports to the building committee, yeah, or back to the state?
No, to the building committee.
So where does the state say, what if this consultant comes up with something kooky in the eyes of the state?
The consultant is...
Or shall I say...
The list of consultants that can do the feasibility study are on a pre-approved list that is certified by MSBA.
Gotcha.
So, yeah. So they've already proven themselves. Okay. You've been waiting, gentlemen, very patiently.
Yeah, correct.
Great.
Just to follow up on something you mentioned before, there was a figure of $6 million or so for energy costs if we were to go down the path of maintaining what we have. Is that a cost that's on top? In other words, it would be good to understand what the unnecessary cost is, or how we're making our situation worse energy cost wise by maintaining what we have now. In other words, is the $6 million total energy bill, or is that a premium on top of what we could be doing?
The $6 million is a total of energy improvements that need to be made to make the buildings more efficient so that...
The current buildings.
All in.
Do we know what the savings would be in energy cost by actually making the improvements?
Yes, we do. That's part of the... What happens, the way an energy savings contract works, is the town engages a consultant to audit all the buildings. And unless the audit reveals that if all those improvements are made, the savings are guaranteed. So that if we spend $6 million, we're saving at least $6 million. And if we don't, the consultant has to pay the difference.
So $6 million over what period of time?
It's, I think, a third. It depends. Each energy improvement has a total investment cost and a payback over a series of years. And that can range anywhere from 3 months to 300 years. So, but we get to choose which ones we want to do. And like, for instance, I think it's in the Gates Middle School, it says energy improvements, but there's four different types of energy improvements that we could do. We could do oil, we could do gas, we could do electricity. So we get to choose which method of that we want to do in the payback. But Kevin can speak much more to that a little later as far as how it works. Yeah?
At the meeting with the superintendent of schools, I raised the question, and he said it was part of the possible MSBA look at the feasibility of adding classrooms to the high school, which you have earlier said, once you move out recreation, once you move out central office, once a early childhood, that type of thing is taken out of that building becomes underutilized. Mm-hmm. And if we were to augment the existing building with however many classrooms were necessary, as they have done in Cohasset, and keep them totally separate, but you have the fields, you have whatever, so that you have moved grade 7 and 8 to that campus, if you will, rather than building a new school.
Mm-hmm. And that will be part of the study.
Just trying to ascertain
that's exactly the type of study that the consultant will tell. It's like, hey, you guys have this idea about moving this out, that increases square footage by a little bit. Maybe all you need is, you know, something else added to that.
I just wanted to be sure that
it could be in a parcel of land we don't even know, or like was already mentioned, it might not be a middle school, it might be a high school.
Always been my understanding of what I've heard from all the different people we've talked to.
They look
from
at everything.
The MSBA and through John McCarthy and so forth, is that they're going to look at all the different possibilities. Okay. We're trying to educate people that when we were going for the feasibility study, we weren't just talking about building a new middle school.
Okay.
And no one's making that assumption.
Put it this way, two things. First of all, the state money is our money too, right? We're all state residents and we pay the taxes on that. So I always kind of laugh when people say, oh yeah, well, that's the state versus the town. Well, no, the state money is our money too, right? Point number one. Point number two is, yeah, the state's not just going to take our word for it. You know, we're not going to be able to go to the state and say, we want a middle school here, and they'll say, oh, okay, here's the check. They're appropriately doing due diligence, as I would, as a citizen, as I would want them to do when they're building new schools out in, you know, Western Mass. I don't want them to take some town's, you know, word for it, Western Mass, that they need a new middle school. I want them to study it to make sure that they're doing the best thing with my tax dollars going to help support that town out in Western Mass. So they're going to be doing due diligence across the board on everything, looking at everything they can possibly do to save costs and, as Tricia said, meet the modern educational models for the best educational system that you can get in terms of what grades are in what buildings and that.
I think, though, that it really needs to be reiterated that you're also looking at the they will be looking at the feasibility of an addition.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Rather than, if people that I've talked to are very frightened about the costs and what all of this means. And so the more information, the better.
So I want to move on to item number three, and that's Kevin. Kevin Kelly is our new facilities director. Kevin's responsible for overseeing all the public buildings and the ESCO project and doing a lot of the legwork for the public facilities master plan. The FY14 budget will create a joint public facilities department. So with the school, we're collaborating with the school, so we have greater centralization, operation, and management. So again, trying to balance a lot of information and getting you folks educated. We're sort of handing out a little stuff at each meeting, but after the last meeting, I asked Kevin to put together just a thumbnail. This is in no way complete, but to just, you know, if you're going back to your representative liaison groups or committees, to just give you a little more information of what our current buildings look like, a little more about the ESCO, and just some of the challenges. Our plan is to get you into all these buildings, tour them yourselves, see other towns, buildings that they've built or rehabilitated, so you have better frames of references for how we compare. And I'll shut up and let you talk.
Jesus, Kevin, this is impressive.
Thank you. Okay, so I can go, in the interest of time, I think we can go through this quickly because a lot of the information that is here in black and white are things that Tricia and Rick have already spoken to and mentioned, but we can go through it quickly and just give you a little idea of what it is. Basically, all this is a little snapshot and little fact sheets of, about things that, we have in the buildings. It's intentionally color-coded. The blue represent the blues on the maps of the areas that are the buildings that are in play as part of the facilities master plan feasibility study. And the only green one I think in here is the town building, which is the Scituate Harbor Community Building. A lot of the things, I put a little, just a little story at the beginning of each one. I could spend days writing out things that are wrong and things that work and things that don't work at each building. But this is just a snapshot, and a lot of the things are pretty obvious, the things that you would expect them to be in buildings that are from 50 to 80 to 90 years old. I did not spend a lot of time at this point going over what I call programmatic issues because people will come in, the superintendent of schools will come in and talk about the schools. Someone's going to speak about the library and talk about those issues. So I'm not as intimately aware of those issues and those challenges as people try to run their programs in their buildings. But in the short time I've been here, it's obvious to me that people are in need of space, in need of modern amenities and things to make things work. So that said, if we look at the first one, the senior center, I mean, I think everybody's comfortable in knowing what they do. In doing some research, I was really surprised to see the amount of numbers and the demographic, I guess, and how many seniors they're now trying to provide service to versus what they used to be, when you look at stuff that Florence has put together and what they're trying to do. And down there, as Tricia had mentioned, there's just one major room, and anybody that walks in, if they're doing something in there, be it yoga or line dancing or having a conference on finances, anybody walks in the door, it's instantly distracting to what's going on. And it took me a couple of times to figure out which door to even use, you know, because it opens up to both streets. The second floor is not inhabitable. It's they do use it for some limited storage, but it's really not pretty up there at all. It's not finished. It's not heated, and none of those things. And it's an old building that needs a lot of help. Handicap accessibility, you'll see that on almost all of these. Lack of storage space, the kitchen facilities there. I believe that they would love to do more with providing meals for people that need meals, and they're unable to do that because of what they have there and looking for other things. The HVAC system is inefficient and very old, actually. And it's hard to temper the space. We have that in a lot of the town buildings, especially the ones on this list. And then the second sheet on each building is what's referred to as a property card. And it's basically just the facts and figures of each place. Anybody's welcome to any of these in any dwelling in the town or in the assessor's office. So that gives a quick snapshot. We don't have to go through all of that. This is for you, everybody, to take, and you can go through that and look at it. It shows the, you know, some of the basic elements of the building, components of the building, the year constructed, and so forth and so on. And then we also included on each building, we included the energy conservation measures that had been suggested as part of this audit that was done by Ameresco. Ameresco being the company who was our ESCO company, our energy savings company. And these are the improvements that they have suggested to do at these places. And that's attached to each one. And I don't think there's need to go through each thing, but each building has that attached.
The mold issue that we had at the Council on Aging?
That's all taken care of.
And that, why did that happen?
Basically a result of a combination of a roof leak and a plumbing leak.
Okay.
That had just kind of been going on and no one really knew what was happening.
Okay.
And it needs new carpet down there and those types of things. And I'm in the middle of putting together prices for all those things to determine, depending on what happens with the part of the feasibility study or what happens with the buildings. Some of these measures, these ECM descriptions, right now we're on our first phase of doing things with the ESCO project. And some of these things we might end up doing in some of these buildings, knowing that no matter what happens, all these buildings will probably still function as they are for at least, is it safe to say, 4 or 5 years?
Yeah.
So it makes sense to, you know, tackle some of these things, which makes sense to save some money and save some energy and provide better comfort and make the space more livable and usable. Gates. I haven't spent a lot of time in gates. Everybody here has probably been in a lot more than I have. I think everybody knows the story of gates. As Tricia said, the building is structurally sound. A lot of the problems with the building, as they did additions to the building, different things made, you know, just worked and didn't work. There's two different heating systems, and to get one room to 60, and another room has to be 80, and it's just kind of crazy the way the whole place works. I was totally amazed when, and I even put it in here because I thought it was such an interesting fact that there's 16 level changes within the building. Which is just amazing to me. I mean, you think of a kid that gets hurt playing soccer and he has to go to school on crutches or something like that. And
you have to go outside the building to get to the cafeteria.
Yeah, that number just astounded me. So because of the different, you know, the additions and so forth, it's all over the place. It's a lot. So accessibility is a big issue. Mm-hmm.
And so Kevin intentionally, as he said, kept the gates thing brief because there's a ton of information on the website about the feasibilities, the programming, and things like that. So he just sort of picked out big items.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also going to have the principal, as I said, and superintendent come in to meet exclusively with the committee.
And all of these, I just tried to identify the obvious and I identify what that was. And like, if you look at the Gates Ameresco sheet, the steam to hot water heating system conversion, we're obviously not going to put that on the top of the list right now until we know what we're doing. But I would definitely recommend we look at doing steam track replacement, because that can save us a lot of energy over the next 4 years. So we will pick some of these things off these sheets as the process goes on, because it just makes sense to do so.
And we also work with the school. The school looked at our list before anything was approved, so they were on board as well in terms of what's happening or what the capital needs are for like Hatherley or Cushing long term. And even Jenkins already needs capital money, even though it's the newest building in town. There's some window issues, there's some heating issues, and we need to make sure that since we're dealing with the issues of the 60-year-old buildings, we want to make sure we're dealing with the 10 or less now to make sure that doesn't happen again.
Small money now, save big money later. And we're saving big money later on all the things we didn't do a long time ago. We don't want to get in that trap again.
Did someone have a question?
So I'm probably misreading this one. But, and this refers to only pricing on B-Wing?
Yeah.
So B and B-Wing is?
B-Wing is the
middle structure.
Middle of it, the middle of the building, right?
The original.
Right. Where the original
B's
portion.
B's the original?
Yeah. A is where the gymnasium is, B is the middle, and then
C is the ugly thing.
Does that pricing came back in this high-level estimate at about $5 million?
Right, just for that
everything.
Section.
Everything? And you mentioned $22 million before to do?
No, that was $22 million to, if we were going to renovate Gates as a school, A, B, and C wings.
A, B, and C wings. And then this is $4 million just to do the energy stuff that came back from Ameresco, some of which is probably
overlap. There's some overlap.
Okay.
Yeah, I forget, in their PowerPoint presentation, I think they itemized, it's called systems or some word like that, and that would include some of this. So there is overlap there.
And can I just clarify, because I've heard the $22 million to renovate it as a school that Rick just said a lot, and people misinterpret that. And so I want to clarify that, because you said it earlier, and clarified that $22 million brings it up to code on everything, all the issues with it, but it gives us the school as built in 1916.
Right, it gives you a building brought up to code.
So not really
that's
a usable school.
Right, it's the school now, improve it to, you know, what it should be if it was adequately maintained, for lack of a better word.
Right.
But it's still a school, and then all those other educational issues are still, I mean, we're looking at physical stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The next one being on the town hall complex, it's the three buildings here, town hall in the middle with the police and fire on each side. And Tricia made the most important point that the town hall was built in 52 using school design plans and actual construction. So it was built to function somewhat as a school. There are big issues in the building as you go around and in the building day to day as far as, you know, use of space, office space, meeting space, confidential space to, you know, have a private meeting and those types of things. In any office you sit here, you can hear people conducting business in the corridors and so forth. And it's, you know, sometimes that's charming, but sometimes it's not.
You're a gentleman.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's charming.
Again, the police and fire chiefs will be here talking more about, I can't do any justice to, you know, what the facts and figures are for response times for the fire department and so forth. Infrastructure-wise, the obvious things with the heat, I mean, the fact that it's a central plant or a mini central plant is not a huge issue. The fact that we provide heat from here to the both buildings is just that it's very old. I mean, the thing's getting serviced almost weekly. The things that have to be done to it. It's an old system that needs complete updating, and the infrastructure going from here to there, the piping. I mean, you can see the windows. And we have window air conditioners.
Right. And he's right, the boiler guy's here almost every week in the winter,
he
and
is.
The heat is awful. It's either freezing or cold. So there's individual units in each office under these windows that were not installed well when they were replaced. So essentially the heat goes right out the windows because they're all right under the windows. And then we had the air tested in this building last year because of what's coming out of the heating vents, because they're so old and people complain about coughing or mold or whatever, and just little things like changing the filters out of the window mounted air conditioners, which are sort of plywooded on the side because you can't get a window unit for a window that's like this anymore. So and the building has lots of challenges, right, just in terms of, Kevin said, we're trying to, you know, be current with technology needs to do service delivery and also for our internal controls, and the electricity, the outlets, the cords are just nightmares to even begin to create workstations for people. So yeah, there's a lot of functional challenges.
We go in offices
challenges.
Behind counters, there's a lot of cords running all over the place because there aren't enough outlets in the rooms. The building, the heating controls of the buildings are a pneumatic system, which is an air, so it's controlled by air, by a compressor, which does not work. So it was a beautiful system in 1952, but right now it does not work. So the building's either on or it's off. There's really, we don't have a lot of good controls in the building. So there's those types of challenges here. And that also affects the police station and the fire station, because the controls are the same.
And the air quality test came back?
They're fine. They're fine, but we have to do them. I mean, a lot of the things, you know, it hadn't been tested for a while, so we need to make sure we do our due diligence and do it annually now. But we didn't have a budget for any of that up until 2 years ago. The override provided $100,000 a year for town buildings. And the entire building below us is a cement basement because they used to use it as the police department garage. So it's not heated, it's not ventilated. We constructed some offices down there, but then we had to deal with the ventilation and heating issues. So it's an interesting place to work. But we've had to do some things, like the treasurer office has no security, so, and you know, they deal with cash and whatever, so we've done that to make sure that that's at least some of those safeguards in place, or some of the offices, just as we're concerned now about school children's safety, we need to be very concerned about some folks who come into town hall and get agitated for a variety of reasons and have a method to be able to communicate immediately with the police department. We didn't have that until 6 months ago. Mm-hmm. So lots to be done, to be done.
Yeah. The next one is the water department office, and everybody's familiar with that, where that is the rotary. And I think this issue is more of a, It's a nice little old building, little old brick building that is somewhat in decent shape. It needs new windows, it needs HVAC issues, it needs some TLC. But I think this one speaks more towards what Fisher and Rick were talking about when they mentioned the town center. It's a horrible place if you need to go in and talk to the water department and drive a parking, you want to go pay your bill or talk about your bill. Same thing, which door do I go in? How do I get in there? Is this the treatment plant? It's not user friendly for the residents at all. So if we did create a place all under one roof and be it the gates or whatever, then it makes great sense to have the water department functioning with those people.
The administrative office.
The administrative piece, yes. So the rest of it would have to stay.
The water treatment plant obviously is not going to move.
Right.
The office itself. And Jen, you're asking about, you know, economics or whatever. So let's tear down that water department building. And we could either expand that park there, right, which would be a very nice gateway and a nice thing for skating and just walking and, you know, whatever. Or I'd be very interested also, you know, geez, what would we do with that spot? It's a pretty nice location in a business district.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great idea. Yeah.
In the library? Same thing, other people will be speaking towards that. It is concerns with the roof. We're in the middle of getting that evaluated. The windows are issues. Some of them, you know, there's some leaks in them. There's a lot of solar issues. Handicap access are issues. Bathroom facilities, parking lot. But again, that's on a separate playing field. But it is, someone else is going to address those issues, but it is part of the whole plan.
Right, so we just included the ESCO analysis. One of the things we'll have at your next meeting is we have a 5-year rolling capital plan. So department heads each year submit requests on a 5-year basis of what they need for capital replacement. Obviously, that can be anything from a DPW truck to a new roof. So what's not reflected in the snapshots you have here is sort of major infrastructure repair that buildings are going to need over the next 2 to 5 years. And so, for example, the library is going to need a new roof. The library has really poor windows as well, which are not here, are parking issues. So we'll have the capital requests over the 5-year rolling for these buildings as well. Right now, you're just, again, just seeing the energy system piece because we have that available to give you right now. And I, you know, we were still working on the capital plan the last time we met. And we'll know what's being funded and what's not by the next time we meet.
Mm-hmm. Trisha, was there a few years that capital wasn't spent at all for buildings?
Marla was on the, yeah, I was on, I can't
the committee at that time, and there were years that we worked very hard and came up with a plan of things that really needed to be done, and then there was no money and it was zero.
That's important for people to know that for a long time things were.
A lot of, I mean, what happened for a number of years is the available funds went into operating. Nothing happened with capital. And unfortunately, I think we've been able to turn that around the last few years so that they run concurrently. But I can't remember what my recommended capital plan is for this year. I want to say it's somewhere on the order of $2.5 million, and the requests just for FY14 were $70 million for all town departments and school. So, I mean, the capital issue is huge, aside from, the building, with the building challenges. So we're looking at big capital investments regardless. Which is, again, which is driving this process a little bit too, which is why we really want to do the ESCO is, all right, what buildings are we going to be in for the next 20 years? And what do we need to survive in them, essentially? Mm-hmm. And the last
one is the community building. And this lists the obvious concerns, which have already been mentioned. The board has directed that we do things to get the building back up and running so the residents can use it for small-type functions, and more discussion on that, and what that actually means. It needs a roof, it needs carpet, there's bathrooms out of service, there's windows that are broken. The HVAC is providing enough to make the building, somewhat usable now, but needs a lot of updating. The infrastructure of the building is poor, it's very poor. From my perspective, my end of the world, it's a typical restaurant thing. People just say, oh, we just fix it and make it work and get downstairs and cook the food. So no one was thinking long term because it was a restaurant for so long. They were just thinking on the fact that they had to keep good customers coming in the door, and that's very typical in the restaurant industry. Parking, I think, is a big issue with that building. We do start to have functions and have things there, and it's depending on the seasons, parking, it gets limited very quickly. And goes on. And another thing that's importantly attached here is the restriction, property use restriction page as part of the original agreement. Trisha has mentioned that a few times. Does that need any more discussion on that?
It's all right there, right?
So the building, the use of this building has very specific restrictions on it. But along with the mitigation fund, when we were allowed by the MBTA to use that money to acquire the building, we also got permission for any remaining funds to use to make repairs and improvements to the building. So Kevin has been working, how long have you been here, 4 months?
Six.
6 months.
Probation? Kevin
has been working on a list of sort of routine, extraordinary and capital things that need to go into that building to open it up for rental functions and income. Council on Aging has been running almost all of their programming out there. Kevin mentioned earlier about the one room and how the interruptions there. Recreation is running many, many programs out there, so the building's being used. But it desperately needs a new carpet. We lost a good section of the roof during which storm?
Sandy.
So we're replacing that. So if we want to charge people $300 or $400 to rent it, we want to give them something nicer than it is. There's a committee to look at the second phase of this building as far as what its long-term disposition is going to be in accordance with the use restriction. But in the interim, that is how the board's going to continue to use the building for meeting space and private functions. Private functions have to be secondary to the primary use. it can't be rented out to a business, it can't become town offices, it can't become a council on aging. It has to serve an educational and community purpose in accordance with the use restriction.
Please do you read these use restrictions, you will get questions about this. It's in here. One thing I found in conversations is when I tell people that the MBTA money was originally intended, and this town negotiated very firmly with MBTA 10 years ago, whenever it was, in the context of the train, money for open space. And we were able to turn that money from open space into this. As people sort of understand that this was the original open space money that we then renegotiated with the MBTA for, then the use restrictions make a lot more sense. That's why the MBTA put these on, is because this was originally open space money, and we said this is public use, because of preservation of the waterfront, et cetera. They said, in that sense, that makes sense. And if you have that in your head when you're reading through this, it kind of makes a lot more sense for you.
Can we just go back to a comment? I forget which one of you made. It's actually the comment that got me really excited. Somebody mentioned $70 million.
I'm sorry?
$70 million. Well, somebody said that if you added up all the capital requests.
Yes, the all departments have to submit capital requests, and for FY14, it's $70 million.
That's requests.
So
if they could have, if everybody could have everything that they felt was needed in the manner of using CapEx or capital funds, it would be $70 million. I assume that includes building a school and everything else?
No.
Or does it just say in place?
That includes fire trucks. That includes...
Okay.
Roofs. It includes the enterprise funds, too. Like, what happens is the capital requests come in judgment-free. So
how much... Let me try this a different way. Of the $70 million, how much of that is associated with facilities of that request? Do you have any sense of that?
In terms of capital improvements to facilities, less than half.
So
maybe even 20%. I mean, I can look at it and give you a more definitive figure. It's equipment, it's seawalls, it's ladder trucks, it's roofs.
DPW trucks,
road repairs.
It's roads, it's sewer extensions, water mains.
I think one of the things that strikes me, and having been the unofficial campaign manager for my husband this week, getting signatures and meeting a lot of people at train stations, I was really taken aback by how free people felt to, you know, give me a piece of advice for him about, you know, all the things that we should be worried about, mainly, and that was not spending money and what the heck is going on in town hall. So at that point, I didn't tell them that I was on the committee, because I figured we can have that conversation later. But sign the paper and get out of here. But it's not. I think that the bigger picture could be a better picture, because painting the big picture as the number you really want without understanding how much bigger the problem really is could actually be detrimental to selling making the pitch and getting it sold. And what I mean by that is, you need, let's make up a number, I don't know what the number is, to do gates, a new middle school, and to do everything you have in mind. Let's just say it's $50 million. But $50 million only really takes care of the blue arrows, right? And the town owns all this other property that has all this unmet capital expenditure, is going to have pent-up demand and ongoing needs for capital over time. And I think that maybe a way to approach this would be to say, you know, here's what the entire bucket looks like, and we're saying we want to take care of a piece of it, a very big piece of it, because we think from a strategic perspective it makes sense over a long period of time. But we're going to not take care of this stuff over here, and we're going to say this stuff over here and the buildings that we're not associating with this master plan, whether it's Cushing or Jenkins or whatever, they're going to have needs over time too. And the town's going to take care of those needs by appropriating capital in its, you know, revenue taking to take care of ongoing needs. One of the things that we've seen, if this happens in the state too, is that it's a build and bust cycle. So you spend no money over time, you build a beautiful new building, and then you let it run basically until it runs into the ground, and then there's like this really big ugly surprise where instead of having taken care of something over time, it needs a new boiler, whatever,
right.
You spend the $20 million or the $50 million that kind of screws people into the ground and makes them crazy. And I think if you could approach this as the problem is really this big, but we're really talking about doing this much, I think it could actually be more appealing than just getting this number that says it's a $50 million problem, we want your $50 million, as opposed to the town really has a $70 million or a $90 million investment in assets, and it's time to take care of 50 million of them. And I don't know that you've got information collected in a way that really helps us understand what that is, but it just feels like right now there's a lot of numbers about what we need as opposed to a great understanding about how much all this stuff really the town is invested in. Do you see what I'm saying?
So yeah, and I think one of the things that we're looking at this committee is how, what other ways we can get to get people to understand this, because everything you just said is on the website. Everything is on a televised cable meeting. Everything is reported regularly in the newspaper.
But it's but think about it as being reported in bits and pieces. There's a lot of information. I went through the entire website and read pretty much everything until I had notes on everything, and you had a few emails from me too. But there's lots of bits and pieces here instead of a cogent, strategic story. And to me, you know, I think about master planning, if I think about strategic planning, I think about it in terms of what do we have to do in terms of, like, a, God forbid, but a PowerPoint presentation that basically tells the town's story about facilities, that is fully encompassing.
Like five bullet points.
No, I think of it as a deck. Possibly, and I'm not volunteering to do the deck, but I think about I've been thinking a lot about how would you do this? Is how do you put it all out there so you can convincingly say in a way that doesn't come off as being sort of incidental, but convincingly position that, you know, we have this bucket of assets, that we know that the ongoing needs for maintaining this bucket of assets, and we know we are, you've got statistics that say other towns have this bucket of assets, they have capital expenditures of X, we are in line, we're not in line, blah, 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 blah. But we've got this, and you know what? For right now, we're gonna sweep away and not talk about these buildings, which we think we can address over the long term, you know, out of, you know, normal capital appropriations. But we've got this bucket that we can't, and we've really got to take care of that. And that's what we need to address, because we think that's the right way to do it. And by putting it in a way that has it all together, and then you get an understanding of why we're doing what we're doing, you know, with just this piece, I think people will feel like we didn't make this up. It didn't, you know, come out of nowhere, or it came out of whole cloth, so that there's a better sense of what the big story is here.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, I think you're gonna get a lot of what I heard trying to get signatures this week, which is all we care about is the fact that, you know, taxes have gone up X, Y, or Z, and we don't wanna hear anything else about that. I don't care about the middle school. My kids went through the middle school. They're in college, they're successful people. Why can't you just fix it and put them in there? I mean, what percentage of the population is, you know, retired or approaching retirement? It's a vast amount of our population that feels that way. So how can you frame this as something that's sort of like a responsible approach to kind of the big story by saying we're not going to pick off everything, we're going to pick off something that we think really speaks to where we get the best value for the town over the long term. And that includes, you know, that allows you to include the, we're going to only address these. In the meantime, we're going to look for properties, as you've even talked about here tonight and you talked about last time, with respect to, can we put properties on the market that will, you know, be for commercial use, which will increase, you know, tax revenues and all those good things, and say, you've got this thing nailed. You've talked about and thought about everything. Now just pull it all together.
Yeah.
And it could start off as a 70-deck presentation, and I happen to think that way because that's how I have to do this in the business world, but, you know, get it all on paper and then just start weeding out what are really the key themes here that get you to a story that you can actually go out and sell, because you're going to have to go out. I think you have to go out and sell this thing, and if you wait to sell it in town hall or the town meeting, you're toast.
It's all about education. People need to...
So nobody's suggesting nobody's going to hear about this until town meeting. That's why we formed the committee. But, you know, we have a tall order here in a very compressed amount of time that's being driven by when the school's ready to come back with their recommendation.
So help me understand that, because that's something else I don't get. When if the school comes, the MSBA comes back in August and says, you know, here's the deal, and then we have X number of...
2 months.
Sorry?
2 or 3 months.
Two or three months to say, yes, we can appropriate the funds, our share, to go forward.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And
that's when people are really going to start paying attention anyways. No one's really going to pay attention to the detailed plans before the summer. We're not going to have a detailed plan, so we're not going to know what summary we can put forth, because we're not going to know where that place is going to go.
So
at that point, we absolutely need to distill down into very cogent sales points, as you were saying.
So at that point in time, we also need to know, so let's say, for example, they come back and say the middle school can be anywhere but Gates.
Right.
So we know that piece. You're having this engineering firm do the better than high level estimates of what it would cost to convert Gates to a multifunctional, a town center, okay?
Yeah.
And you're also having, did you say we're paying another firm to do estimates on what it would cost us to put the public
schematic
safety?
Schematic design for a public safety building.
And that's already in the works.
Right. And,
yep,
and when's that? When's that coming back?
When is that?
That will probably be May, June or July.
So before that. So we'll have that piece known, so when this MSBA comes back, we can put that figure in. Library stuff will have been moving forward in one direction or the other, but then so we'll have that moving piece more constrained.
Mm-hmm. But what the board has decided the plan will be is that everything goes together in the fall, and that date wasn't a date we picked, but it was selected in order to be able to not miss the funding opportunity for the school project.
Which is obviously
right.
The largest.
So there's a couple, we're not going to separate projects, we're not going to do one project and then another project, we're doing all in. And that's a decision that the board has made with the agreement of the school committee to go forward and do all of this together.
Correct.
And the date could have been at any time, but has been more accelerated because we were able to just get in that little window to appropriate the 750 without having an election or an override to get the school feasibility study done a year sooner than any of us anticipated. Mm-hmm. So that sort of moved us all up. And then the library queue came up, 3 years sooner than any of us expected.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a huge, huge amount of work. But that's what the board has decided, and that's how we're going forward.
On the one hand, there are certain advantages to all this, because then we can start saying, okay, it won't be if the senior center or if this or if that. It will be, yes, the senior center, we will put that on the market, the spot, or whatever. So these are, you know, it's a budget. This is the amount we expect to generate to help defray these costs.
But if the town votes against this, that means you don't go forward with at least doing the school, right? Because you're doing it all in?
Well, there has to be two separate questions, because the school MSBA requires a standalone question.
Okay.
So that's, you know, and those are that's for the voters to choose.
Constantine?
Yeah, I was just thinking, listening to some of the activities, some of the decisions are going to take place, and within a very short period of time. I'm just wondering, is there any flow chart that identifies all the activities, who's deciding, when they're going to be decided, how much is it going to cost each of these activities? So, I mean, this is a simple question people ask. If we're going to do this, how much is it going to cost, and when is it going to be done, and who's going to do it?
As a flow chart. Yep.
Yeah.
So there's a schedule involved, there's money involved, and there are committees involved, and now you have the state involved, too.
Absolutely.
So you have to start to synchronize.
Yep, that's a great point.
Great point.
Yeah.
Flowchart.
Yeah.
And this, just a quick question on the, is it October or November? Do we know the date of that town meeting?
No.
No.
We always have a town.
Do you find out in like September?
When?
Do you find out in like September when the date is set?
No, the date of the fall town meeting is driven by the business of the town. But it has to happen before the middle of November because the tax rate needs to be set. So any expenditure of funds needs to be completed or we can't set the tax rate. And if the tax rate's not set, then the tax bills don't go out on time and then we have a whole lot of other problems like cash flow.
So it won't be earlier than
November. So it has to be, the last 3 years we've had it between October 15th and this year it was November 13th, which is as late as it can be.
So it's usually a week after Columbus Day weekend or something.
Yes, it's in that window, mid-October to mid-November.
This involves, you know, town meeting, putting it on the ballot, and then is there a time frame for when that ballot election has to happen after town meeting?
It's usually 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
I just want to add, you know, Constantine's absolutely right in terms of a flow chart, et cetera. And I know that you're all into the internet and putting it on the website. And unfortunately, be that as it may, there are not all that many people, especially seniors, who are really into using the webpage. And if you want to sell this, then I think that there needs to be a pullout or sheets, tear sheets, whatever, at the library, at other public places, that people can obtain this information without going onto
so
the internet.
Flowchart, yeah, that's dispensable around town.
Yes.
Well, we did something similar to that, Tony, when we had the Pier 44 public meeting.
Yeah, you just put it at the library,
April, it was everywhere.
Yeah.
You know, it was on the internet, and it went everywhere, and 90% of the people that showed up were the elderly, you know, trying to push us to vote for a senior center, which we couldn't do.
Right.
But they got the word out. They were there.
You have to get the word out,
and it worked. So do the same thing.
Karen, to your point about if the what if it doesn't pass the vote, say if the school passes, but that's where why we can't get together yet where it's going to go yet, because if MSBA says we're going to give you money for a school, but it has to go here.
Mm-hmm.
Like literally here. Well, that would be interesting, wouldn't it? If MSBA says it has to go here and the town passes the MSBA warrant article, but not the rest.
And how would that, and then how?
Huh? What do you do then?
Yeah, so, what do you do then?
Yeah.
Put it to another vote.
Is that?
And put it to a second vote.
Yeah, you've got to figure something out.
But, school over again.
I don't think that's going to happen, but there are still, and that's why I said you've got to circle that date when the MSBA comes back. Another option could be that they say, put it up at Ellis, as we just said, already in planning. But then you got to vote. People could vote for the school and not for anything else. Right? And they say, we're cool with the school. That's great. You're getting the 40% match. It's the price I can have. But we're not going to do the town center part. We like the water department where it is. We like your boiler. Right? Well then, okay, we vacate gates, we put everything in the new school, and the town's looking at plywood on gates for X number of years, and I guess we'll just either try again or revise a plan or whatever, because I think in empty gates after a couple of years, people would start saying, they're banging on us about flipping Pier 44. They're saying it's not being used, when in fact it is actually being really, really used all the time, as Tricia just said. I think the town's going to react when they actually have an empty gates and it actually isn't being used, then, you know, so it might not work, but that's, like I said earlier, we're going to appeal to the legislative body, which is the special committee, and see. But we really don't know any of that until we get that MSBA report that says what the options are and where that school's going.
So you have to, I mean, for purposes of being as ready as you can possibly be and avoiding the what is up to me really feels like a scramble. This is a very short period of time to get a lot of information together and to get a lot of people educated. You really have to be anticipating what you think they're going to come back with, which would dictate that, which would suggest that you would have we would have the opportunity to take gates on as a different use in a school and go with the thinking that that's the pricing you're going to have to come up with as in addition to public safety facility, right?
Yes.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's no question there's a lot of work and, you know, there's very limited staff to do it. And But again, you know, I think the board's very committed. It's been their priority for the last 2 years, and you know, the buildings aren't getting any better. But I want to let Mary Ellen do her thing about the library. I asked Mary Ellen, and actually she asked me, but I think we were thinking the same thing, but not talking to each other, that the library received a grant, a $5 million grant to rehabilitate the library based on a very, very competitive grant program for funding of public libraries in Massachusetts. And there's a feasibility study that was done that I directed people to on the website. And I want Mary Ellen, who's been very involved in it as a trustee, to sort of share with you the building challenges, what the new addition would do, and how the funding would work. So why don't you?
I can just actually just sit here.
Yeah, okay.
Just don't have my back to anybody. So my name is Mary Ellen Gaziano. I'm the chairperson of the library trustees. And this has gone back since before I was on the board in 2005, when they started looking at the size of the library and the use of the library and the amount of programs and people that come in. We've done a couple of surveys of the town. What does the town want for the library? And the biggest things that came back was they wanted more meeting spaces and more quiet space to do homework or study groups or smaller meetings or larger meetings, as the case may be, downstairs. So we went into this grant round, which is very, like Tricia said, it's very competitive, and we were awarded the $5 million. And like any state grant, they're very particular on what you can do and what you can't do. So we really had to go with their guidelines. So the building came back at a $12 million renovation and expansion. And this is what the renovation would look like. All of this, I didn't make any fancy copies like you did. but it's all on the website if you're interested in going. So this is what the new library would look like with the expansion on it. And I thought it was important for us all to be aware of this project in conjunction with the other project, because like the school project, we can't go into another project with the grant round. It has to be a standalone vote for the library as part of just one library building. We can't get mixed in. So when the town came back with the survey and what they wanted, and we did the grant application, and so it's a $12 million project, $5 million coming from the state. The Library Foundation has a very large goal of trying to raise $5 million. to date, we've almost reached a million, right? And a lot of projects going on around town, a lot of excitement going on. People are very enthusiastic about the project. You know, there's nobody that doesn't like going to the library or has something bad to say about it. I think it's a place where people enjoy going, from babies that are 6 months old to 90-year-olds, people that, you know, come for a variety of different reasons. So it's an exciting project. It's coming fast and furious, and it's we expect it to be 3 years out from now. And when what happens is we got in this queue, and then towns couldn't appropriate the money, so they dropped out of the queue, and we started to come up. So we're 3 years faster than we thought we were going to be, which really put pressure on the Library Foundation to get that fundraising going, and just to get the word out, to educate people. So we are we still on the April town meeting?
Yes.
We're looking for an extension from the state.
When do you hear about that?
We haven't even heard when we can go ask about it.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. sometime in the spring, so we're thinking around April will be the meeting that we can go ask for the extension. So they're giving 6 months extension. We're in the middle of writing a draft to go to legislatures to ask them that this is really possible for us. We really would like a year extension. We don't know if that will happen. So So if we get a 6-month extension, we will be at the fall town meeting with everybody else. We're not quite sure with the fundraising how much money will be, you know, the town will need to put into the library to get us to where we need to get this project off the ground. So there's a lot that needs to be done at the library. We have a new roof. We need windows. This has been on the capital plan since 2007, I believe.
And it's like $2 million.
It's about $2 million.
And we've informally expressed our support, I guess would be the word, for the $2 million.
Mm-hmm.
But that still leaves y'all for the $5 million of the fundraising. $5 million from the state, $2 million from the town, $5 million from the board.
Right. But what I was talking about was the money that needs, the library needs, if we didn't do a renovation expansion.
Yeah, is that still about $2 million?
It's still about
$2 million. Yeah, it's still about $2 million, right?
Yeah, it's a little more, I think, because Kevin, didn't you get a better estimate on
that? I'm waiting for that.
But yeah, that was probably 2007.
And that's
yeah, it's probably 2.2.
Yeah, that's critical.
It's a little higher.
Yeah, that's critical stuff. Just for the ex-nef only.
Right.
Yeah.
So we talked earlier about having those buildings that get to be 90 years old that have run into the ground that you end up spending $50 million on. The library's 35 years old. It needs some repair, and we're mm-hmm. trying to say, okay, this is a time that we should be thinking about where do we want this library to go? We want to keep it the way it is. We want it to be a nice library. We want to serve the community. We want to bring it to the 21st century.
Is there any overlap in the programming you're thinking of, you know, that's associated with more meeting space, with meeting space that would be provided as part of so-called community center and this town center?
Yeah.
I don't know. I haven't seen them.
One of the benefits of having everything co-located in the town center is you don't need as many meeting rooms in there because people can be sharing meeting rooms.
Yeah.
Certainly a community center and senior center up there, so they would be able to leverage off each other and so on. But if the library stays at that location, which it would under this model, then they can be essentially autonomous in that space.
The other thing that we have to keep in mind is that libraries need a weight-bearing minimum because of all the books, and I'm not sure that Gates would be able to support
the weight of the library. I think I asked my last question poorly. How much of what happens in the manner of community meetings happens in this building because there is not a community center in town, and that would naturally gravitate away from the library if, in fact, you did Gates as you're envisioning today as a town center?
How much is the library used for community stuff? I actually don't think much.
Not much. It's mostly library programming.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It is the only meeting space in town that holds more than 20 people, the community room.
Yeah,
and it's in it's in constant use. Mm-hmm. Constant use.
So that space would be freed up.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Yeah.
That space would be freed up.
That space would be freed up, but it's
freed up.
One room, really.
Yeah, it's a big room, but still one room. Yeah.
That's the thing.
If it's in constant
good size
use,
meeting space.
Both of them might still be in constant use.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There still might be a need for one at the library and one at the.
I mean, when you consider that this is our town hall, there's one meeting room, and there's often two or three meetings going on here. They're meeting in the break room. We had conservation here the other night, and capital planning had to be in my office.
A lot of resources right now are in Albania's office.
Right. So.
And any community group that tries to find a meeting space in town has a horrible time of it.
Right.
You know.
And the Maritimes Center is great too, and that's available. But a lot of our meeting space maxes out at like 15 people comfortably. So if you have any kind of planning board meeting, conservation, you know, it's great if there's, you know, six people on Capitol that can meet in my office, but if you want, if the public's really going, that really doesn't cut it.
And I'm on community preservation too, and we've been meeting at WPA building, but then we run into conflicts there because other groups meet there, so we can't meet there on Monday nights.
Same JR Hall.
And we meet at the JR Hall on Mondays. But I think besides the community room aspect, part of this plan for, and I'm on the library campaign committee, which is why I'm here, but part of this plan in the lower level of the library is that that would be an area for the youth of our town, that our teens need their own separate space. If you're ever in the library after school when the junior high kids are there, I mean, it's nuts. So they would have...
In a good way.
Yeah, and it's very exciting, but if you're...
The hope would be that would be at the community center at...
Yes, but no, but it would be their own team, not a community center, but it would be their use for the library. Okay. That they could go there after school because an excellent school system also needs an excellent library.
Absolutely.
So if the library expansion includes a teen area, an elementary area, then they can go there and after school and do their work. And it wouldn't be... You know, it would be much more beneficial to them. So I think that that's what is planned. If you look at the plan in the lower level, not necessarily meeting space, although the basement area that is unfinished certainly would be finished as part of the plan, and then we would have more meeting rooms too. So, I mean, it would solve a myriad of problems.
Okay. Bill, you've been uncharacteristically reserved here this evening, sir. What are your thoughts on something?
I think you're hearing a lot of good points. I think Karen, Jen, and Ann put some good points out. I think when you get all finished, it's got to be more than a number.
Yeah.
It's got to be more than a number. And I think, Karen, you're spot on. We're coming back up and we're spending the capital money to maintain all of our structures. But we've got specific problems that need to be addressed in these following structures, the opportunity that presents itself. That's the story.
Yeah.
Right. The unfortunate part of the story is it's going to cost you $100 million.
Right.
But this is a story that has to be told so that the people understand, rather than just sit there and say, "You want to spend $100 million?"
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's an important key.
Yep. That's right.
And I think it's a point that people for years have been saying, you know, why isn't there a plan? Why aren't we looking forward? Why aren't we looking to the future? And I think that that's happening, and I think that's exciting. And just to get that excitement out to people.
So
we're not looking for next year. We're looking for third years.
So will the library be a third warrant?
Mm-hmm.
So let's just say it goes yes, yes, and no to the third one.
To the library?
Yeah, because people say, you know what, enough is enough. Let's just say that happens. What can we include? Be thinking about including in what's going to happen at a Gates that would solve some of the problems that are at the library. Because I think, you know, you really got to think about, you know, in the pecking order, you're really vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're going to be, yes, a smaller number, but you're going to be the third one. And the appetite we know for spending money is really sketchy to begin with, right? So how do you, if you can't have that, how do you get some of the programming needs that you have addressed in a more of a town center?
Personal opinion, I don't know if I can speak for the Library Foundation, but I know from the trustees is that we would hate to see the library be put into a town center. We really, and that's something the town has to decide, but we really believe that a library should be a place where people can go as in one spot and not in a...
Has there ever been any thought, I don't even know if it's permissible in the way things are funded with the school system, about associating a library with school?
We've asked both those questions actually, and at least right now, in terms of the grant funding, they will not fund something that's part of another building. So we would be responsible if we wanted to do that for 100% of the cost, either at Gates
or as part of, oh, we're building a new school, why don't we add a library, because schools have a library component. I spoke with Jesse about that, our library director, and at least that's the current philosophy of the Mass Board of Library Commissioners.
But in the spirit of what you were asking earlier, or Jen was, or Doug, or you guys saying, we need to know that number, so we can point it out that the renovation of the extant library with the match is less expensive, assuming it is less expensive than us just walking away from the $5 million from the state and building the library as part of the school library.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We need to be able to defend that.
That has to be part of the story, is that
we're putting it in the gate. Yeah.
Part of the story has to be the cost of not doing any of these,
yes,
these three parts.
Yeah, yeah,
that's
yeah,
what I was getting at, but
that's right.
Right, and so as we build the building profile, we could say, here we are today, and if we're looking at this status quo 3 years out, this is what it's going to cost in terms of capital improvements, operational costs, and things like that as we build the building profile. But that's an extra point, is what we're trying to do is really quantify the cost of keeping the status quo, both in capital and O&M, and just in terms of how the world is changing.
And also quantifying the cost of something different, something
right,
new,
right,
but different from what we're proposing.
Right.
So it would be something new if we're rebuilding a new middle school here with a new library to weave in the town library functionality there and the building and so on. And that will cost X.
Mm-hmm. Right. And we'll be giving $5 million back to the state.
And includes, and so with the $5 million from the state, it costs Y.
Yeah.
And look, Y is less than X.
I mean, it's pretty standard, but you really have to spend some time figuring out what the PMO is, make the comparison, because I think you've got a valid story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we, in the same vein, though, and I've had this conversation with Jesse, if we increase the footprint of the library with the new addition, does, you know, that increases utilities, that increases custodial, does that increase staffing, which it doesn't.
Right.
That's an important question.
That
doesn't increase staffing, maybe custodial, clearly utilities or whatever.
And it would be
We have to do that for any new facility or renovated facility as well. What does it do aside from the capital cost? What are the operation and maintenance costs to run that new or rehabilitated building?
Mm-hmm. What's the total cost of the library?
$12 million.
You have a commitment from the state of California
for $5 million.
And this is a commitment. It's not an earmark. In other words, there are some conditions attached to it, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And what's the condition? To get to raise the balance, which is about, what, $8 million?
$7 million.
And how much of the match do you have right now?
We raised $1 million. We raised $1 million.
And you still have $6 million to go.
And the board has committed to $2 million of town fund.
Well,
to put forth for town meeting for $2 million.
And $4 million would come from appropriation. Is this involved in the capital plan? Is it shooting it next year?
No, the remaining four.
So you have to raise it.
Fundraising,
yes.
Or it becomes part of what.
And you have an extension of 6 months in order to come up with the balance.
We don't have any extension as yet.
No.
So
if they don't get the extension, it's a whole new ballgame.
I thought there was an extension.
No, they
only
you requested an extension.
We will. They'll let us request an extension in April, a 6 month extension.
So by calendar this year, it's either up or down.
And if we don't receive the extension, if you don't get an extension, what's going to happen?
This extension is pretty much a formality, we think. Because they've moved the timeline up so fast that they're giving that extension to pretty much everybody, so we're just assuming it's a formality. But if we don't get the extension, we'd have to go in April to town meeting.
They have a placeholder on this town meeting warrant.
They go to
because
town meeting for
the question that goes to town meeting is all $12 million. So the entire $12 million has to go to town meeting. Authorization to go for an override. Yeah.
My only concern here is that there's so many town constituents are going to be faced, and these are the voters who come at the town meeting, and be faced with major projects,
mm-hmm.
major appropriations. It's competition. The A's and the B's and the C's might be swayed to vote on one plan and reject the other plan. And you see, the timing doesn't seem to be very practical at this point.
We didn't pick it.
Dealing with money is unpractical. Fiscally, it's not being responsible, I used to say that.
Well, I think you raise an excellent point, but one thing I think that weighed heavy with the board is that it has the potential to be divisive, and so in order to mitigate that divisiveness is to do it all together and let the community decide all at once, because we don't want to say school children are more important than seniors. We don't want to say that town hall is more important than the library. We really don't want to do that. And because all the buildings have almost equal needs in terms of their challenges.
So the bottom line is 12 million from the library, and then you have more millions coming from the other projects. And what's the magic number at the bottom?
We don't know yet, because there's still many moving pieces. What the school price will be, if it's a model school, which I personally would anticipate it being, but who knows what the price of the school is. There's a 40%, I believe, match from the state on that number. How much they fundraise on the library, how much our costs, we're still building our funding model, how much the public safety building is going to be. There might be grants out there that can help defray some of those costs or not. Whether some components are put into gates or not as well.
And so then we have that number and that back out the revenue offsets we're looking at.
Right.
Like the educational study could come back and say close an elementary school. So then we have to plan for how that elementary school, what, you know, the school has already had some discussions, I'm sure, about what that might potentially look like, and then selling properties and things like that.
And another thing, we want to drive down the number, right? So the number that everybody's going to talk about, how much is this going to cost $500,000 home in terms of a tax increase, right? Then we need to do calculations on, for example, let's say we sell the senior center for X, let's say we take a certain amount of the revenue stream from wind and from solar and perhaps the meals tax and these other things, how much of that do we, using household mortgage lingo, how much of that do we apply towards the down payment, and how much of that do we apply to the bond, right? Whatever works out best to drive down that tax increase is what we're going to end up doing. So we don't have any of that yet, because we don't know what the cost
is. So you will have the answers to these questions come from town meeting?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's what, yes. Yeah.
Well, beforehand, kind of to get... working on tonight?
Yeah.
We need to get it out before then and educate everybody.
No, right. Yeah, absolutely.
It is. But, and I mean, we don't have any, you know, flies on us that it's a huge job and it's a huge undertaking, but this is what... You know.
All right, we're coming up on 9 o'clock.
So you, right? Have you covered everything?
I think unless anybody has any questions.
That's very helpful.
And I had done a presentation a couple weeks ago to the selectmen's, and that is on the website. It's got more detailed information, but I just tried to give you an overview.
Thank you. So going to item 6. We want to weave in the police chiefs to come to a meeting and talk about their building challenges. And it's not March 12th, because the Board of Selectmen have added a meeting March 12th, since the annual town meeting warrant needs to be done by that night. So I think our next meeting will probably be the 19th, if that works for folks. Do you have a board meeting the 19th? I think you might. So.
That might be the empty day that I said I could do.
I don't know.
If
that's the case, they can still meet, because the chiefs are doing the meeting, and I don't necessarily have to be here.
19th has a selectman meeting.
All right, so...
26th.
So we'll still meet the 19th, and we'll do the police chiefs. So the question becomes, touring the building in the evening versus touring it in the light of day, and whether folks on the committee are open to meeting on a Saturday morning to circle through all these buildings. We've done that in the past year with the advisory committee, and the capital planning committee is actually doing it March 1st, which is Friday.
Friday?
Is that Friday?
Yeah.
sorry. Ever since the storm, I don't know what day it is. And they're actually touring all the town facilities, the sewer treatment plant, the water, whatever. So does a Saturday morning, probably in March, so we're not anticipating a snowstorm, work for people for like 8:30 to 11:30 or something like that. And maybe we can weave gates into if we have everybody together. It's not going to take, it'll take like an hour, 15 minutes maybe to do this complex. And then if we get everybody over to gates, that would be helpful too since it's so close. So I'll try and set that up and have a date certain by our next meeting and talk with the school department.
If the Saturday wouldn't work for us, could we look at maybe doing this Friday with the advisory board? Or
well, they're not doing the buildings in the master plan. They're actually doing the sewer treatment, the water treatment, the transfer state, the DPW buildings.
Okay.
So you're happy to go, though. Anybody can go. But again, the frame of reference is really, really helpful. So, all right, so I'll try to set up the building tours for that and also work on the feedback. I'll drill down more on looking at the $70 million in capital requests for FY14 and see what that constitutes because, as I said, not a lot of it's in this.
And you have it, and you also have it for 5 years, right? You said
it's a 5-year rolling capital plan. Yeah.
Just as a suggestion, if you could tell the group the rules for being a capital item.
So a capital item is $25,000 or more, and a useful life of 5 or more years. So like a police cruiser is not a capital item, but it includes all moving equipment, buildings, and infrastructure. And I'm going to work on that flow chart, but I'm going to make Constantine help me with it, which I think is a great idea.
Yeah.
So
with all the numbers.
Yeah, with all, well, we're working on the numbers. I still, but I mean, the nice thing is, I mean, we can get some frame of reference for some things because other communities have built, you know, Hingham is building a middle school now. Norwell just, you know, went with a proposal for a new police station. So, you know, there is some information out there. It's just not going to be exact, and then we'll be able to back it up over the next few months with the actual cost estimates that the architects will provide.
You know, just to conclude, everybody in this room, we're here because we're interested, and we're also probably innate problem solvers. And so it's natural for all of us to focus on what we don't know and what we haven't accomplished. But if you think back to where we were a year ago, when we were just talking about this, we've come a hell of a long way. We've got design plans at the rectangle level at gates. We've got things going on with the library. We've got things going on with the contracts, with the public safety. We've made a lot of progress, and let's not forget that. Let's make sure we help communicate that. But like I said, we all hear like problem solving, and to solve problems you have to focus on what we don't know and what we haven't accomplished. But there's a lot we've done, one way to go, but there's a lot we've done. In fact, I'm encouraged that there have been very few questions, important questions, but very few questions that have been asked in the last couple meetings that we've had where everybody in the room has said, Jesus, I have no idea. You know, we at least know where to go to get the answers, and we have some pretty good answers to some of the questions. So we're getting there. And don't forget that.
And the other thing is, I think you all have my email address. If you have questions, Karen emailed some stuff and email I was able to answer. So please feel free to email me. And if I don't know the answer, I'll try and find out for it. So it's not just wait till our next meeting every 2 or 3 weeks. You know, we're really here to help. There's not a lot of us, but we're certainly here to help in any way we can to get you answers.
I've been saying that this town has ignored infrastructure for 50 years, and I think that this Board of Selectmen and you as Town Administrator Tricia have done are really to be commended for taking this in hand, and so thanks.
Well, thanks for that. No, I appreciate it. Well, there's a nice way to motion to adjourn.
Did we decide on March 19th?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Any motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion made, second.
Okay.
All in favor?
903. 903.
Thank you.